Welcome to the Archaeology Studio. Today's episode is about pottery analysis in archaeology. By the end of this episode, you will be able to discuss what we can learn from archaeological pottery. You should be familiar with the potential research questions and practical observations. Furthermore, you should be prepared to apply this knowledge in other situations with different artifact assemblages. This presentation concentrates on pottery, but many other products could be made from baked clay or ceramic material. In the archaeological literature, ceramic objects refer to anything made of clay that was transformed through heat. This material happens to be useful for making containers known as pottery. The individual pots could be created in diverse forms and styles, and they break into fragments that we identify as potsherds in archaeological sites. In the global archaeological record, numerous categories of ceramic ornaments and tools have been identified as pendants and beads, spindle whorls for weaving, weights for fishing nets and other fishing gear, statues or figurines, and, of course, pottery. Among pottery-using groups, pottery tends to be abundant, and moreover, it reflects the combined technical, artistic, and other traits of the people who made and used the pottery. With the diverse factors involved, pottery traditions are highly sensitive to variation in different contexts. Through careful analysis, pottery assemblages can be associated with their original contexts of geographic areas, cultural groups, and time periods. Accordingly, archaeologists worldwide have identified numerous pottery traditions or wares. Pottery traditions or wares could be described according to many different criteria, depending on whatever specific attributes might be observable in a particular assemblage. Firing temperature directly affects the material result of any baked clay object. More heat will create more extensive transformation of the raw material through the process of vitrification. A category of earthenware refers to the lowest firing temperature for the initial effects of vitrification, generally in the range of 800 through 1200 degrees centigrade. Higher temperature will create a category of stoneware, wherein the vitrification has been sufficient to create a waterproof material. Stoneware generally is fired at temperatures of 1100 through 1300 degrees, and it often coincides with metalworking technologies that involved specialized control of fire. A category of porcelain is fired at a high temperature, generally at 1200 through 1400 degrees. This thoroughly vitrified ceramic material tends to be white and translucent. The firing in this case is possible only in a specialized structure such as a kiln. In a large scale and long-term view, most archaeological pottery has been made of earthenware. Most stonewares and all porcelains have been produced during historical periods with written chronicles of their contexts. Different research questions, methodologies, and practical observations would apply in the cases of ancient archaeological pottery. Archaeologists often begin with describing a pottery assemblage and then clarifying what specific traits were distinctive of their associated geographic region or time period. Other questions involve how the pottery was manufactured, how it functioned, and generally, how the objects might reveal more information about the people who made and used it in the past. Pottery assemblages are most informative when they are obtained from confidently dated contexts. In this way, you can clarify the chronological order of the artifacts, and you can trace how their many different traits changed through time. In each potsherd, you can examine the raw materials, thickness, manufacturing technique, decorative expressions, and other individual attributes. All of those observations work toward defining the larger pottery tradition, and then you should be able to specify the geographic area and the time period of the tradition that you are describing. This approach provides the most essential factual framework for all further research questions about the artifacts that you are studying. Before you start examining a pottery assemblage, you should be aware of how the individual fragments of potsherds relate with the possible shapes of the original vessels. You can think of the overall geometry of a pot in terms of what it might have looked like if it had been a complete sphere, oval, cylinder, or other shape. As containers, however, pots were made with openings, typically at the top. If the opening was designed closer to the top, then the resulting shape would be a restricted form. By comparison, a lower position could create an open vessel form. You could describe any pot as a sphere, an ellipsoid, an ovaloid, or other geometry that could be either restricted or open. You next can consider the pot's main body angle, ranging from vertical through horizontal. A number of conventional shapes could be described as jars, bowls, dishes, or platters. You should be aware of how the numerous fragments were broken from the original vessels. Each piece can be attributed to a portion of the pot's original anatomy. Rim pieces can be identified as broken from the upper opening of a pot. Base pieces can be difficult to discern from generalized body pieces. Rim pieces can reveal extra information that you cannot always see in most body fragments. With rims, you can observe more clearly about the profile shapes of vessels. Additionally, you can measure the diameter at the position of the rim. Base pieces usually were made thicker than other parts of a pot, and they could be either flat or rounded. Body fragments typically account for the most surface area of any pot, and their total numbers can increase the confidence of defining a pottery assemblage, especially when looking at the basic attributes of material composition and manufacturing technique. Depending on the vessel shape in question, you potentially could see other anatomical portions, sometimes described as elements of carenation, shoulder, or neck. When working with these kinds of complex shapes, you should remain aware of how the carenation or other element was positioned within the overall anatomy of a pot. In some assemblages, you may see additional parts of lids, footings, or handles. After you can observe the physical characteristics in a particular pottery assemblage, then you can develop realistic research questions based on the actual observations that are possible in the given material objects. For example, you could pose questions about how the pots were made and used, or about the variation in the forms and styles. When developing specific research questions, you could frame your research with reference to the life history of the artifacts, involving the collection of raw materials, the manufacture of the objects, their usage in cultural contexts, and their eventual discard into the archaeological record. You might focus on one part of the life history, or you could examine the entire cycle. In any case, the scope depends on your interest and on the limits of the possible material observations. Even the smallest piece of pottery can reveal information about its raw materials. The material composition or fabric can be assessed visually in some aspects, or it could be measured in more detail through geochemical analysis. You can think of a pot's material composition as the result of a recipe. The clay comprised the primary ingredient, modified by adding temper and mixing with water. People needed to collect the clay from a geological source. Certain colors and textures of clay may have been desired. An extra step of processing may have been necessary to remove plant roots or rocks. or those materials could be retained for their effects on the clay recipe. In most cases, temper was added for controlling the workability of the clay and especially for affecting the performance during the stress of drying and firing. Thin-walled pottery necessarily would include fine-sized grains of temper, while thick-walled pottery potentially could accommodate larger sizes of temper inclusions. Typically, water was added in order to achieve the desired amount of flexibility of the clay recipe. In some cases, minerals from the water source created additional effects with the clay, and potentially those minerals could be identified in the geochemical composition of the pottery. After mixing the clay recipe, the act of shaping a vessel may have involved a number of interrelated steps. You could think of the initial primary forming of a basic shape, followed by secondary forming to refine the shape, eventually ending with the finishing procedures. Primary forming refers to the creation of a rough initial shape. The simplest technique may have been to punch a lump of clay, perhaps aided by pinching. Other approaches were to build the shape through coiling or through conjoined slabs. Sometimes the traces of coils or of slabs could be detected in broken pottery fragments. Another effective technique involved making a mold, perhaps in a pit or in a basket. After making a rough vessel shape, secondary forming enabled a more refined result. One of the most popular approaches was to beat the exterior by hand or with a paddle, usually while bracing the interior by hand or with an anvil-like tool. Another popular secondary forming technique involved scraping away excess material from the exterior or interior, sometimes removing the traces of earlier forming actions. The finishing stages refer to the final treatment of a pot's surface. Rough portions could be smoothed through brushing or wiping. Formal rubbing or burnishing could create more polished results. Other treatments could include incision or other decoration. Most finishing procedures were performed after a pot had been partially dried into a leather-hard condition, and some finishing potentially could occur even after the firing of a vessel. The final steps in pottery making were the drying and firing. The drying process was necessary for ensuring thorough and even distribution of heat while firing. The firing process itself needed to be at high enough of a temperature to start the vitrification process and transform the raw material into a ceramic product. In profile view, some potsherds could display relics of their firing environments. If the fire was open, with more oxygen interacting with the pottery, then the oxidized condition could create more reddish color. If the fire was closed, with little or no oxygen interacting with the pottery, then the reduced condition could create a black coloring. Firing cores could appear different in fine versus coarse clays due to the ability of heat or oxygen to penetrate through the material. Other differences could occur when organic matter, such as wood or leaf material, was touching the surface of pottery during the firing process. When interpreting the results of a pottery analysis, you need to demonstrate a logical link between the objective raw data and your interpretive conclusion. Toward this goal, pottery analysis brings an advantage of being able to work with large numbers of objects and observations. Raw counts or weights can be measured for each category, but those numerical values alone could be misleading. Ideally, you can calculate the amount of pottery and other material per unit of volume in an excavation as a more realistic representation of how much material density or concentration belongs to each separate stratigraphic layer or other association. The calculations of material concentration next could be subdivided into their individual categories of findings, such as the different vessel shapes, the decorative traditions, or other observed variables. In this way, you could trace the chronological trends in how some categories gained or lost popularity through time, relative to one another. As you have seen here, pottery analysis can offer wide-ranging insights into the archaeological record. The durability, abundance, and diversity of pottery can support numerous research programs. In concluding this episode, now you should be familiar with pottery analysis in archaeology. You can evaluate the capacity to make material observations and to address significant research questions. Moreover, you can apply this knowledge in a variety of situations, not only with pottery, but also with other artifact assemblages. I hope that you enjoyed this episode and that you will explore more with the Archaeology Studio.